He called this place an almost Eden-like beauty. He said the Y plantation has an Eden-like beauty. But then, of course, he described the horrors and the blood and the beatings and the whippings and the killings that he witnessed here. He first learned what slavery meant here. He learns also that slavery is property. He learned about property here. Everything was property at the White House. It was all about property. This was an amazing enterprise, a gigantic agribusiness. He first learned human relationships here. He had learned about love from his grandmother, and maybe a little from his mother, Harriet, but he barely knew her, and he did not even know his siblings until he arrived here. He learned love here. He learned all kinds of emotions here. He also learned to dream here. It's kind of what those blackbirds were about for him. But he learned to dream here, and part of that dream was down there on the docks, seeing the Sally Lloyd, the sloop out there, because it was always going in and out, and in and out, and in and out, and going to someplace called Baltimore. And he later writes about what he called his Baltimore dream. If anyone wishes to be impressed with a sense of the soul-killing power of slavery, let him go to Colonel Lloyd's plantation, and on allowance day, place himself in the deep pine woods, and there let him, in silence, thoughtfully analyze the sounds that shall pass through the chambers of his soul. And if he is not thus impressed, it will only be because there is no flesh in his obdurate heart. Analyze the sounds. Douglas was essentially saying, I couldn't understand those sounds either, but God, they were profound. And God, they moved me as a kid. So if you want to understand slavery, go sit in the pine woods, hear the music, and then if you can, analyze the sound.
And based on Douglas's experience here, it's no wonder in my view that as a writer, as in my view, one of the greatest nonfiction writers in the English language, Douglas relies time and again on the idea of sublimity. And the sublime or sublimity is an aesthetic that encompasses both terror and delight. Douglas's own job, as he points out on the plantation, the years he lived here, he drove the cows up in the evening to keep the front yard of the big house clean so that the facade looked good. That was his job as a 7-year-old boy. And Douglas captures the sense, the texture of this immensely profitable, huge, big business. It's the foundation of the industrial corporation. In reading Douglas and in spending time here, you get a sense of the felt experience of what Douglas may have understood, may have helped. And I think it's invaluable what the Tillmans, what the family has done over the years to preserve the house and to acknowledge the significance of this for memory, the way in which the past can shape the present and the future, can influence it, and to be honest and open about that past. The evil as well as the beautiful.
But this was one of the largest plantations of the era here on the shore. But the integrity of this built environment between the great house, the orangery, which is one of the remaining of its kind, to the captain's house, to the hallowed grounds of the cemetery, and also the African burial cemetery that's on the grounds here. The natural environment, when we speak about that from a preservation perspective, for those that drove up the long lane, the trees that we would call witness trees that have witnessed the rich airs of the periods of significance associated with this place, to the land, to the water, like the Miles River, which would just be somewhat of a stone's throw in the opposite direction from where we are sitting. As we look at what the anniversary of this place is approaching, it is approaching 360 years of existence. What a remarkable legacy of an American story, not just an African-American history and culture or Eurocentric, but it is a national treasure connected to our American history and on. But it's most interesting to remark about the development of Douglass's character and his understanding of slavery, which, as both Blight and Stouffer have mentioned here, he really learns from this place. The great house and the great farm, if you will, really instilled a sense of purpose, I would argue, in Douglass's life.
Without the White House, we might not have a Frederick Douglass, or certainly not the Frederick Douglass we have come to know. This is an experience that makes him the quality leader that he becomes. It is your hardship, this growing up, claimed as property, held as a slave, that actually makes you a better leader. In the case of Douglass, that's what's going on. This is the school. And so I often compare it to training for an event. You have to suffer a little bit to get the rewards that show up when the game starts. And so Douglass suffers here, but he maintains a sense of self because he understands that his life is bigger than the moment. Frederick Douglass and the White House is invaluable to the American experience. Without his experience here, who knows where we'd be? Without Frederick Douglass, where would we be today? We can say that slavery would have been abolished without Frederick Douglass, but I will say slavery would not have been abolished without men like Frederick Douglass, without women like Frederick Douglass. And as has been mentioned before, his legacy is a legacy of service. His legacy is a legacy of service. So as we leave here today, and I'm talking a little bit before because we're not thinking about leaving really, but as we leave here today, I hope that we all keep in mind that his is a legacy of service, and that service doesn't mean a servant who is a slave, but service means a free man who cares enough about his fellows to make sacrifices and to work for their good. That's Frederick Douglass.